That's that guy from the Space Trek show, right?
Yes. Space Trek. He was the captain of the Space Trek.
That's what I thought.
Yeah. Captain of the Space Trek.
Yes.
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim, Doc, and Chris discuss an attempt to define the differences between video game reboots, remakes, remasters, remixes, and reimaginings. Plus, we introduce some new segments and preview E3. Backward-Compatible.com podcast starts right now.
Backward Compatible.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to podcast number 31. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined by Jim.
I'm here.
And I'm joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And what do we got going on today, guys?
I think I'd like to start us off with a little button mosh. Go around the table, see what everybody's been playing lately.
Get ready for the button mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
Chris, let's start with you. What do you got?
Well, I've been playing not very many games recently. We're in the middle of relaunch week as we're recording this, and so I've been quite busy with editing and other things outside of Backward Compatible, of course. But what little I have played has included Splatoon for the Wii U, and I'm actually really enjoying it. It's a very very neat little game. I'm finding that it's appealing to me a lot more than any other online shooter. Console-based, you know, shooter that I've played in recent memory.
Is it all online?
Yes.
Or is there single-player?
Well, there's a single-player mode, yes. There's also an offline split-screen mode. Essentially, one person plays on the TV while the other person plays on the Wii U gamepad.
Oh, okay.
So you can do local multiplayer, and it's a different mode than the typical online version. I'm still a low enough level that I haven't tried the rank battles yet, which I believe are more like a capture-the-points sort of territory control, whereas the main mode, the standard, like, play-with-anyone online mode, is what they call turf war, which you basically, each side squirts different ink out of their weapons, different colored ink, and you're trying to cover as much of the playing field as possible with your ink and try to cover up any ink that they've put on. And so if you control 50% or more, or rather not 50% or more, because it actually calculates based on total coverage of the field. So say you only cover 90% of 100, you know, you might have one side with 45%, the other side with 45%, but neither has 50. But point being that whoever has more territory control ends up winning the round. And that's it's interesting because it makes it so you don't have to be a super skilled player fighter in order to play this game. I think it appeals both to people who like to play shooters and can strategize and really get into it, but it also appeals to people who kind of want to stay out of the fray. And basically, you can just sort of go off on your own and be painting territory when no one's around. So you don't have to be worried about, like, oh, I need to be right here, right now, and taking out these people. I think it's, and what's nice about it, too, is there's no voice chat, which is something that's always bugged me. So I think in a lot of ways, it kind of does for me what Hearthstone did for me, as far as getting back into online play, which is I don't want to deal with people's BS. I just want to play a game and have fun. And, you know, I like playing against humans because it makes for a good challenge. I've really been enjoying Splatoon so far.
Here, here. Cool.
Well, I know, me personally, I haven't really had as much time to play this week as I would like. I have played more Witcher 3, which is a great game. I did hear that they, in their first week, I think they passed the 4 million mark.
Oh, wow.
4 million copies sold, which is pretty nice for them, because I know they're not a very big studio, actually. They're a small studio out in Poland, so it's kind of, I'm sure it's exciting for them that they've gotten this much press and recognition.
Doubled the Polish economy this
well,
week.
I was reading somewhere that Witcher 2, like, all-time sales never even got to 2 million, so this
really?
Is kind of exciting.
Oh, wow, that's
for
cool.
them to already be this far ahead.
For the record, I'm part Polish, so.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Do you know any about the mythology, like, the mythology of your culture?
No, not really. I wouldn't
supposed
even call
to be
it my
sort
culture.
Of based on that? Or?
It's Polish descent.
Okay.
And even then, it's only 1/4 of my mom's side.
Oh, okay.
So it's, like, 1/8 of me.
I was hoping you were going to reveal that you're actually a Witcher.
I'm actually a Witcher, guys. Yeah. So I'm so good at editing is I've got the AV monster parts embedded in me. So yes.
So your cultural history and your personal awareness of it basically consists of all the Polish jokes you've ever heard.
To an extent, yes.
Okay, wow.
And good food.
Wow.
So.
Oh, well, that's true, too. That's fantastic food, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing food.
So. Yeah. I'm also a little bit Lithuanian, and kind of the one little bit of history I know about Lithuania is that they were the first country to break away from the Soviet Union. So that was kind of interesting.
Well, there you go. Mm. But more importantly, how are their game development studios?
That I don't know.
No. Okay.
Yeah. But no real specific, anything specific to say about it. I haven't really been haven't played more than about a couple extra hours in, so nothing new.
Nothing
to
too
report
breaking.
Just yet. What about you, Doc?
Well, I've actually been getting back into Broken Age, for no other reason than sheer stubbornness. The sort of hatred that I spewed last week, I feel like I need to do a retraction, because. I actually made some assumptions after playing it, which is that it spoon-feeds you childishness at the very beginning. Mm. I believe is what I said, or something almost as pithy last week. Mm-hmm. And what's interesting is that the contrast that's set up by not only that, but actually the flip side of the story, because you can choose... if you get stuck, this is one of the really neat things about it. If you get stuck, you can actually flip over to the other story,
mm-hmm.
and then you discover very quickly how those stories intertwine. At first, they just sort of parallel each other, but then they actually affect each other.
Oh, cool.
And by the time you get to Act 2, you need clues from one story in order to be able to solve the things from the other.
Mm. So what's the idea behind the game? Is it like people in two different time periods or two different dimensions?
Well,
or?
It's a bit of a spoiler, actually. But I will tell you, everything is not as it appears. From the beginning of the game, one appears to be almost a fantasy type setting.
Mm-hmm.
These great warrior clan has been reduced to calling its town Sugar Bunting, and they're all bakers.
Mm-hmm.
And so you literally start out with Fluffy Cupcake Land on one side, and a teenager being treated like a baby as far as he's got baby's toys, mm-hmm. and the steering wheel squeaks and things like that. There's literally nothing adult, and I mean that in the calmest sense of the word, but there's just nothing to appeal to an intelligent human in the first, let's call it 15 minutes of both storylines. So depending on when you play it, you're gonna have to go back and then suffer through the stupid on the other. Well, see, the thing was, I, in my infinite wisdom, went ahead and Googled then before last week, and it was some terrible phrase like Broken Age stinks or Broken Age is terrible or something like that, and immediately found people who supported my viewpoint on this, but didn't actually bother to read what they had said. And if I had bothered to read what they had said, I would have discovered, because I went back and reread it, I would have very quickly discovered that there's actually a strongly divided opinion on this. Some say that the first act is brilliant and the second act ruins it. Others say that the first act is terrible but is redeemed by the second act. And that's really interesting. So the twist...
You're in that camp?
I am actually in that camp. I am in the camp of the second act redeems the first. And I find it to be really fantastic storytelling and amazing and wonderful gameplay in the old school way of adventure games. But as you know, with any adventure game, there's going to be a point where you kind of go, I'm stuck. Well, the neat thing about it is you can flip over to the other story and continue that one. At any point, you can flip back between the two stories. One's a female lead, one's a male lead, and so on and so forth. So I retract what I said last week. It's actually, I think, a very good game. I haven't gotten to the last part of it yet, so I may come and do a re-retraction next week and go, it's terrible, the ending's awful. But
I hope you do, because that'd be fun.
Wouldn't that be great?
Yeah.
Double retraction.
But so far, let me put it this way. The amount of time that I've put into it, which is probably about 10 hours or so, because I really hate looking it up and solving it. I'd rather go meticulously through and try to use the talking spoon on every item in the game, or every interactable object in the game, before looking it up. But the little fun thing, it does actually say in the description, it's a series of puzzles which will amuse and I think it's like be very difficult for you, and one really hard one that you're going to look up on the internet, which I think is very clever, because whoever
they're aware of the culture now.
Yeah, exactly.
That's funny.
So anyway, if you have a chance, or when it goes on sale probably next year, pick it up, because I think that everybody who enjoys adventure games, and that's my big proviso, if you enjoy adventure games and you do not immediately enjoy what you pick up, slog through that stuff. It redeems itself.
I think I might own that game, actually, because when the developer had a Humble Bundle, you could pay above a certain amount to essentially back the game on Kickstarter, which would then get you a copy of it. So I think it's somewhere in my library. I just haven't gotten around
that
to
it
yet.
That makes sense.
This is the Gaming Meta. News and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
Have y'all heard about the fallout on the on Steam's refund service? Because there's been some issues where apparently people are getting refunds for games that are like 5-6 months old. It's apparently some developers are losing quite a bit of money on refund sales.
Yeah, I heard about the Steam refund thing, but I haven't read too much about it, so I don't even necessarily know, like, on what grounds could you ask for a refund?
Well, it was originally, the idea was supposed to be that if you had only had the game and played for, like, a couple, I think it was less than 2 hours, if I remember correctly, you were supposed to be able to get a refund. And it was supposed to be less than 2 hours or, like, some small amount of time, like 2 weeks or something.
Mm-hmm.
But people are finding, you know, leave it to gamers to find a way to break the system.
Yeah.
They're finding out that if they only have a small amount of time played, they can get a refund.
Like 5 months
even
later.
Though it's several months later, and that was never the intention
by
Steam. So apparently there's been a lot of developers complaining. I follow George Broussard on Twitter, who he's actually the designer of Duke Nukem, used to own Apogee Games. And he keeps tweeting out saying that he has a lot of, you know, all of his developer friends are really concerned because they have a major loss in profit from this.
I wonder, because that's a tricky thing too, and you know, this isn't the first thing recently. We've talked also about the mod situation with Steam, where they're kind of experimenting with new services and having some issues, but
they instantly sort of back down
on
that one.
The thing with the refunds is, like, I can see the argument that, you know, they do 2 hours worth of playtime, because if it's anyone like me, you know, you're probably not going to get to the game until 3 months later. Like, I buy something when I can afford it, and I don't play it until I can. But then if I, you know, play it for 2 hours, I'm like, this game's terrible, I want my money back, which I'm not really that type. You know,
right.
I just kind of bite the loss.
Yeah.
But, you know, if someone hasn't played it, you know, at all, and then decides when they do play it that they want their money back, but it's 3 months later, you know, it's kind of, it's a tricky situation.
And one of the issues, the problems with that, too, is that, especially for a lot of the smaller developers, you know, they're trying to get, you know, their finances in order on, like, a quarterly basis. And if all of a sudden it comes back and they have all these losses for money they have to have refunded.
Yeah.
You know, 6 months down the line, as opposed to it happening within the same, like, sales quarter,
right.
Then it's a much bigger hit, because they're not expecting that. It's like all of a sudden you have to pay a bunch of extra money that you were not expecting. You were expecting to be in the black, as it were.
And I can imagine
in the red.
I can imagine a situation too where people, like, all buy a game and then there's some sort of, like, boycott over some sort of content that someone finds offensive, and then basically there's a giant, like, upswell of people refunding because of that.
Get me started. I want to start ranting about people that, like, you should be offended. I like that. You should be offended. If you are playing a game, maybe that's a little bit harsh, but I think that's where games kind of, the one direction games need to go, and that's something that if we want to get into the games as art discussion, which is not really one for today, but if you're not disturbed by it, then it's not art. So if you're offended, do it.
We definitely need to stick a pin in that one.
Yeah.
Because that's, I think, going to be a great a little
be
top.
Be offended. I want you to be offended.
for our sex and violence episode coming up soon, possibly next week or the week after. There's really interesting thing about what you were saying with Steam, though, and that's the psychology of the purchase.
Yes.
Which is, it's the idea of buying something on the end of the shelf. You walk into the grocery store and there's gum on the end of the shelf. I mean, you know, the Wrigley Empire was built on this impulse buy.
Mm.
And I think there's a lot of impulse buy in, let's just say, Kickstarter, the indie game industry at large, Steam, that sort of thing.
Steam sales in general.
Yeah. So as soon as you create a situation where you can do a buyback, I honestly think they should gamify it. And the clock starts ticking almost immediately. And then game time reduces it more quickly. Game time played And then real time also reduces it very, very slowly. And then what you can do is sort of like at GameStop, where you take, you know, your big stack of games and you go cash it in. You do the exact same thing with your old Steam games. And you're like, I want to deactivate this game, this game, this game, and this game. Whoa, I just got myself $5. Sweet, I'm cashing it in for this game.
Oh, it's an interesting idea, actually.
Yeah, so
The sale of used digital games, which is when we get into really weird territory with DRM.
Yeah. So I don't know if it's even possible, but yeah, you know, GameStop's gonna have to figure that out, or they're gonna go out of business pretty quick.
Cause oh darn, that would be such a shame.
Wouldn't it be terrible?
It would be terrible.
Yeah, but I say that because I think disc media is going away very quickly. There's a local store in the Dallas area that's the movie trading company, and there's a really interesting history behind their sale and
I really like downturn, that place. By the way.
I know, but there's just not much there that you can't get on, say, Amazon Prime.
True. I still want it to be... I mean, there is actually the sort of movies that I tend to get a lot of...
That's like, probably true, Jim.
I pick up a lot of old, like, foreign films and old, like, 70s and 80s kung fu movies. So I pick up stuff that is, like, not really the sort of thing that you're going to easily find on Prime.
There you go.
I can find it on Prime and have them mail it to me like a disc, but I'm not going to find a digital version of it.
Sure.
But anyway, so moving on, I did want to mention that I also found out that Chris Avellone left Obsidian, and that's a name that, Doc, you might know pretty well. He's
my uncle.
Oh.
not really.
But he used to work at Interplay. They did games like Fallout 2 and, of course, Planescape Torment was a big one, and then later Obsidian... and Avellone worked on Fallout New Vegas. It's one of the most recent projects. Before that, it was games like Knights of the Old Republic 2 and Neverwinter Nights 2. So, you know, they have a pretty big RPG background. As far as I know, he hasn't really said what project that he's going to be working on. He was working on before the Planescape Torment spiritual successor.
Yeah. Does that have a title? Everyone calls it the spiritual successor.
Yes. It was called... Tides of Numenera.
It's a terrible
Torment.
Title.
It's called Torment, : Tides of Numenera.
It sounds like a disease.
Yeah, it's not the best title. they probably should have just called it, like, Torment, but...
You know, I think I might have actually contracted that whenever I lived in Guatemala, up on Lake Panajachel, I went swimming. Don't ever swim in Lake Panajachel in Guatemala. You will get Torment, : the tides of... I don't even know what you're saying.
Well, you'll definitely get torment in your colon. We'll leave it.
Yeah.
But I did kind of want to throw that out. I don't really know if there's really any comment to say, other than I am a little concerned in terms of what he might be doing and what you might be working on. Hopefully he still has a connection to Tides of Numenera. I don't think that was an official Obsidian project. I think it was his own Kickstarter thing with a bunch of people that worked at Obsidian, so it wasn't quite the same thing. But that was one that I was looking forward to. One of the early Kickstarter projects that's been in the pipe for a while. And also one of the most, if not the most successful, of those.
Now it's time for Table Talk. Discussions on tabletop games of all kinds.
This weekend, I did go to the North... I had to write down the actual full name. I've just been calling it the RPG Con. It's the North Texas RPG Convention. So that was held over, it's over technically in Fort Worth, it's over by the Dallas Airport, the Marriott Hotel. And it was pretty interesting. Most of the games, well, all the games that they had there were either old games from the early 80s or sort of like a retro reinvention of those old style games like Dungeon Crawl Classics.
Right.
I know y'all have some familiarity with that system.
Mm-hmm.
But it was sort of interesting because I've only really had experience with newer games. The games that were here, a couple of them that I played were both made before I was born.
Oh, fun.
It was kind of an interesting experience. I played those two in particular. One of them was called Boot Hill, which was made by TSR. It's also one of these... it was one of their, like, after Dungeons & Dragons games that didn't quite catch on.
So TSR being the studio that originally made Dungeons & Dragons.
Mm-hmm.
They did Chainmail and all that.
Yes.
So, cool.
Yes. And Boot Hill was originally, especially first edition, was really more of like a miniature game. And I apparently we were playing the third edition, which is a little, which is supposed to be the best one, but it still was very.
I'm more of a 3.5 man myself.
For Boot Hill?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't even know if that exists.
I don't know. Either. I have no idea.
It was definitely very rules intensive. It took us about an hour and a half to get our characters going. There was all this little extra minutia. I can't say I enjoyed it that much, to be honest. And I think, but I will say that a lot of that I think kind of goes down to the. GM, he was very, very strict about what he allowed you to do.
Yeah,
very.
That's kind of old school. Yeah,
very, but pushing the rules too. Where you know, if you're not letting your players be creative, they may not have as good of a time.
Yeah,
things like wanting to kick over a table to shoot someone. Of course, it's Wild West setting. I should probably say it all takes place at Boot Hill. Kind of makes sense.
Gotcha.
We were sort of doing a Magnificent Seven. We were each one of the Magnificent Seven characters and went through and played that. But yeah, he didn't really like me trying to do things like kicking over tables and hiding behind him and shooting over the ducking over the table.
Gotcha.
Or, you know, one of my friends was involved in a duel and I said, well, I come up behind the guy while he's in the duel and just shoot him in the head. Mm-hmm. Well, you can't do that. Mm-hmm. Why not?
It's not a listed maneuver.
Can I try to do that? No, he's in a duel.
Yeah, okay. The 80s was the height of kind of the simulationist movement in role-playing.
Yes,
game.
Very true. Yes.
I think that was the point at which people were wanting the sort of depth that you can get in computer games before computer games could do it. And then we got computer games, and then we didn't need tabletop games to do that, and then we started moving back in the direction of now having kind of this like new indie wave of like narrative driven and rules light sort of stuff.
Which is funny because with a lot of these role-playing systems, they have sort of maintained, like, I mean, I'm sorry, video game systems, I should say, have certainly moved more towards rules, very specific rules heavy as well.
Right.
So I don't really get that impression. Like, if you want to play something that is more freeform and creative, you kind of do have to step into that tabletop RPG space.
Oh, I agree. Yeah.
So, but yeah. So the other one that I play that I did want to talk about or touch on a bit was Dungeon Crawl Classics, just because it's a sort of a retro reinvention of the old D&D rules. And what I sort of discovered, because I have played DCC before and didn't have quite as good of a time, and this time I had a great time because our GM was actually a theater performer and clown in his off time.
Oh, wow.
And, yeah, he was very accomplished. He was really into improvisation. Absolutely loved it when I would start throwing him a whole bunch of curveballs because it gave him the opportunity to come up with something even crazier.
Cool, cool.
And so I kind of reached the conclusion that, you know, really the most important part of any sort of RPG system is the GM and the other players.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't really matter if the system... Of course, system is important to a degree, but if you have a good GM and you have good players, it's going to work. You're going to have a good time, even if you don't like the system. And the reverse is true, too, unfortunately. If you don't have a good GM and you don't have players that are willing to play to the story.
Mm-hmm.
I know Doc probably can talk a bit about that, players not playing to the story.
No, I have no idea. I've only written essays on that. Nobody's read them, but...
Well, maybe they'll listen to them.
There you go.
Yeah.
Go to adambracken.com for the complete listing of things Doc has written that no one has read.
But you'll eventually convert those into audio essays and they can listen to them.
That's absolutely correct. So. That is a good point.
I was trying to lead you to say that.
My quick shout out for Tabletop this week is just to Craigslist, all of it, to say... that I dug through my closet because I'm actually moving house and made a stack of stuff that I was willing to sell, put it on Craigslist, and within like 5 minutes started getting these, like, aside from the weirdos, genuine calls about, hey, you want to, you know, sell this one? You want to sell that one? Do you want to trade? That kind of a thing. And I walked away with actually some cash in my pocket and really good trades. Mm-hmm. So I'm looking forward to talking about some of the, like, even vintage stuff that I picked up.
Well, you got it out of someone's trunk, right? They came by with a trunk and came up with this car.
You make it sound dirty that way.
I was going to say, because I actually have a couple of games in my trunk right now. So.
Hey, we'll talk after the podcast.
you exchange unmarked bills for the pieces.
I just forgot to get them out of my trunk when I moved. I was just remembering I have like these really old, terrible games. Like I have like the old X-Men board game, which is not much of a game to it.
Nice.
But it's interesting because it came with all these really cool little figures, like plastic figures.
Mm-hmm.
It's the best part of the system because you get all these figures to have. It has like 30 or 40 figures of all the different X-Men.
That's cool.
The game itself sucks, but the figures are cool.
Oh, okay.
And I'll toss in one more quick note for Table Talk before we wrap it up. I'm actually very excited about a new show that's starting up. Will Wheaton, who did Tabletop on YouTube, is also now doing the show. It's a spinoff of Tabletop where they're playing a role-playing game. And it's actually using... it's actually the first setting designed for this new system from the guys who did the Dragon Age RPG. It's a generic version of it, which I've actually really been wanting them to make.
A generic version of Dragon Age? Wow. That must be really generic.
Setting free is what generic means there.
I'm just being sarcastic.
Setting agnostic is probably the better term.
Doesn't know whether or not it's a setting.
No, but the point being that it looks like I've watched the prologue chapter. I haven't watched the first episode yet, but really looking forward to that when I can. I would recommend anyone who's into role-playing games, and especially seeing what role-playing is like. I've actually shown Tabletop to people a few times to sort of demonstrate what tabletop role-playing is about. They do a good job of sort of explaining how things work and how the game is meant to flow and the interaction between GM and players and that sort of thing. I would head over to Geek & Sundry and or YouTube and check that out.
Now, is Will Wheaton going to give us a plug as well late in his first episode?
Maybe.
Kind of go back and forth with it?
Pay it forward? Yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
Hashtag Will W. Have my baby.
If someday we actually get a shout out from Will Wheaton, I'll probably be very happy and excited. I'm not expecting it, but hey, Will, yes. If you happen to hear this at some point, you're cool, and shout out would be awesome. Thanks.
That's that guy from the Space Trek show, right?
Yes. Space Trek. He was the captain on the Space Trek.
That's what I thought. Captain of the Space Trek.
Yes. We say that as Star Trek nerds, so that's...
Yeah. Actually, I have a rant for about the new Star Treks, but I'll save it.
I'll save it for other stuff at some point.
No, I'll save it for the reboot in a minute.
Stick it in there.
Yeah. All right. do we have that sound for the stick of
minute? I just made it.
Oh, so there we go.
Icebreaker.
Yeah, so I did want to talk a little bit about E3 just because it is coming up next week, and that was the subject of our very first podcast, was the E3 in 2014.
Yeah.
There's already been a little bit of news that's been trickling out of E3, mostly rumor, some of it already confirmed. One of the biggest stories is Fallout 4, which has a setting, Boston. Have you all seen the trailer?
I've seen the trailer, yes.
Talk?
Yeah.
Okay.
What's funny is that, like, I heard later that apparently a bunch of people are complaining about the graphics. And
the people have always complained about the graphics.
Which is like, it looked fine to me.
They could have filmed it in full HD with actors, and people would be complaining about the graphics.
Like so, 4K.
Yeah, that doesn't. Yeah, that doesn't. Yeah, whatever.
Well, then it was just FMV. It wasn't running an engine. This is deceitful.
I remember when 16-bit was awesome.
I'm fine with 8-bit, so these people complaining about graphics need to just calm down.
It's not as awesome, but I'll give it to you.
Whatever happened to gameplay is more important than graphics.
I think that still kind of holds true. I just think that there's a lot of people that they want to be, especially with the new generation, there's this sense of, I paid $400 or $500 or some of them even $600 for a new console, so I expect to be wowed by my
graphics. A significant upgrade. It was actually funny. I went back and I looked at one of the first trailers for Grand Theft Auto 5, and having just seen that recently in the PS4 version, which isn't even as good as the PC, there's a stark, noticeable difference between the graphics on the PS3 version and the PS4 version. It's one of those things where I think you know, you're sort of like comparing apples to apples to an extent, and like the new generation's like, oh, this guy's slightly better this or slightly better that. But then you compare it to the last generation, then it is a noticeable difference. And so, I think that anytime you get a new generation, the upgrade's good enough that you're going to miss it if you don't have it.
Well, I mean, I've been playing, I didn't this past week, but I do have NBA 2K15, which I did mention last time on the podcast. Mm-hmm. And that game looks, you can mistake it for watching NBA game on television. It looks that good.
Except for the frame rate.
Certain angles, it depends on, right, exactly. Yeah. There are some frame rate issues, but it looks very good.
Oh, yeah.
Significantly better than the PS3 and Xbox 360 version
of
that game. So, you're right, there is definitely an upgrade there. But getting back to Fallout 4, we don't really know a whole lot about it. Yeah, we don't really know a lot about the game just yet, but... I enjoyed Fallout 3 to an extent for what it was, just because I'm a huge fan of open world games.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't really feel like it felt like a Fallout game until we got to New Vegas, which I felt really did sort of embrace the old concept.
Mm-hmm.
That's sort of why I was a little concerned about
Fergus Urquhart was on that project, so that makes sense.
Yeah.
Is he on 4?
I haven't heard.
As far as I know, no, because he's with Obsidian. Oh. That's the thing. That's why Obsidian, that's why Fallout New Vegas felt like a Fallout game, was because Obsidian, which used to be Interplay, did Fallout 2. So they had a Fallout connection. So they had those people there, like some of the core people that worked on Fallout 2 and were instrumental in sort of fleshing out and building the Fallout world, were able to step in into that, you know, broken mess of an engine that Bethesda gave them for Fallout 3. Sorry, and I say this as someone that played all the way through Fallout 3 and, you know, enjoyed myself in parts, and there were, you know, things about that I liked, but the engine was a mess.
Did you actually play the isometric demo for Fallout 3, the original Fallout 3?
Van Buren? That was the codename.
Was that it? Yeah, I think you're right.
The codename was Van Buren. Yes, but I mean, it was just like a short little...
Yeah, it was off of Fallout 2. I mean, it just felt like Fallout 2.
Yeah. Fallout 2, I
ask because you're a fan.
I loved Fallout 2. Fallout 2 is my favorite. I think it was an improvement over Fallout 1.
Poor Sulik.
Again, had issues towards the end. There's a little problem at the end of the game. Problems with the ending. There's potential glitches. The other big news piece, I don't know if you... Do you play Fallout? Do you want to get in some Fallout talk?
I was just going to say, I've played Fallout 3 and a little bit of New Vegas, but what I was intrigued by in Fallout 4, the trailer, was how they kept showing the before the nuke and after the nuke footage. And I was curious if they're just doing that for artistic purposes, or if maybe there's going to be some mechanic where you can actually go back and forth.
Oh, it was my favorite DLC.
Because that would be really cool if there was some way...
You remember that one? Actually, there were two.
You mean the one where...
Fallout 3, there was DLC where you could actually go back in time and you could replay it was the mission in Alaska that basically triggered the end. And then there was another one, which was you were in virtual reality and you were...
That was the one that I remember. Yeah. I liked that one. I didn't like the...
It was like in black and white and everything.
Yeah, I liked that one where... I know some people were saying, oh yeah, you can play before the bomb, and I'm not. That doesn't really interest me.
Mm.
Because that's not... The Fallout world is what takes place after. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's kind of the story. Mm-hmm. So I don't really see the point. It's like after Mad Max, some people were saying, when the director, and I forget his name, I'm so sorry, but was saying how he was going to do a prequel, and my immediate thought was, oh, he's just gonna do, you know, an earlier story than the one that he had told, but still in the Mad Max universe, and still after the bomb, and, you know, in this post-apocalyptic world. But some people were thinking it was going to be before everything, before the economy and the world started to go to hell and all that. Then it's not really Mad Max. So same thing here with Fallout. You do it before that world, yeah, you can do like a little quick, you know, short little DLC or like a flashback or something and maybe get some sort of, like, some sort of story element from it, but otherwise it just doesn't interest me.
I'm with you on that one, Chris. I think it'd be awesome.
Yeah, I think it'd be intriguing too if there was some way that, like, you know, almost an Ocarina of Time style, doing something in the past then like unlock something in the future.
Yeah,
but then that would make the past... You would be playing way too much in the past. It's called Fallout, guys. Fallout.
If it was,
it's Fallout
selectively done.
It's a metaphorical Fallout.
No, I'm not buying it.
The consequences, and also there's time travel. So,
so before we get back into the time travel discussion, let's get back to previewing E3. So yeah, what else is kind of on the radar for you guys? I know sort of what I'm looking forward to.
There has been some rumors, and I don't know how much stock you want to place in them, because there's probably this rumor probably comes out every E3, but there are rumors that there could be a new Metroid in development that might be announced at E3. Of course, that would be great news for me. I mean, I'm a huge Metroid fan.
Mm-hmm.
I even like, you know, I know some people, as the Prime series continued, sort of, some people didn't like it as much.
Mm-hmm.
I still thought Prime 3 was great. I still enjoyed it a lot.
I
so I'm certainly looking forward to a new Metroid, if there is one, but...
We'll see.
For whatever reason, Nintendo seems like they just don't... It's like that's the one series where it feels like they just kind of stepped back. Because really, they haven't done anything Metroid.
Mm-hmm.
They haven't made any real Metroid games since, what would it be, I guess, Zero Mission?
Because
they didn't make the Prime series. That was Retro.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And they didn't make Other M. That was Team Ninja.
Yep.
And that, oh, what a great game that was.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think Retro did a good job with it, though. And the Retro
I agree, with Retro, is
a Nintendo subsidiary, so it's
still... Well, it became that. Mm-hmm. Initially, they weren't. They were independent when they did Metro, which is what it was so strange that Nintendo let them take one of their marquee series and just go to town with it, with Prime.
Mm-hmm.
They later bought them, but yeah, at the time, they were not a subsidiary.
Interesting. But yeah, I think Nintendo is really the only company I follow closely during E3. Like, I'll sort of I'll naturally through the grapevine, through Twitter or whatever, be hearing about like, oh, this new game just was announced and this trailer's amazing, but I haven't found myself watching many game trailers lately. I just sort of play the games as they come out, so I mean, if there's something I'm really excited about, I'll check out trailers and stuff, but like, Nintendo is really the only company I follow around E3 time, and it's been that way for years now for me, so I'm looking forward to that tournament they're planning to put on, so...
That's right, the Nintendo World Championship, is that what it's called?
World Championship. So mm-hmm. I think they're playing 8 different games. The only confirmed one that I'm aware of is Splatoon. It's the first time Splatoon's going to be played in a tournament setting. They've like announced a bunch of guest players that are coming on to participate and all that sort of thing. So
there's no Donkey Kong tournament?
That I don't know. Okay. It could be because they said that they're going to be bringing back some old school stuff. So I'm curious, too, when they said there are 8 games, if it's like 8 separate tournaments or if it's like almost this like... octathlon of gaming where you have to like compete in 8 different games to be the best or something like that.
I really doubt that's it, but that would be a really cool idea. Yeah. I love that because then you've got especially if you could maybe like get a team together, mm-hmm. but not one for every game, of course, that would be fair, but something like, you know, four people to a team, mm-hmm. and you could have something where you pick who's going to play this game. And you kind of have to pick, you sort of like balance, okay, is this guy might be really good at this game, but he's mm-hmm. terrible at all the others, so maybe we shouldn't have him on mm-hmm. our team.
Maybe someday we'll have the backward compatible octathlon.
Yes.
And, we'll
there you go.
Do that, so.
That could be fun.
Cool.
I guess my answer to the question is the Lego game, Lego Dimensions.
Mm. Worlds, you mean?
No, well, Worlds.
Oh, Dimensions,
is,
yeah.
Worlds is kind of out already, isn't it?
It's early release.
Yeah, that's what mm-hmm. I thought.
Early access.
But anyway, anytime Lego does anything, I always kind of watch it and dismiss myself casually from the room whenever I find out what it is. Uh-huh. But lately, I think they've been doing some really cool stuff. Ever since Lord of the Rings. Lego and then The Hobbit. I mean, mm-hmm. I think that they've really succeeded, mm-hmm. and so I don't know. Being a transmedia guy, I go to transmedia conferences, and then of course the natural question that's always asked is, "What's your favorite example of transmedia?" And my answer is always Lego Lord of the Rings, a video game, because it's a video game based on a toy, which is based on a movie, which is based on a book, which is based on a world created by the very first, you know, visionary of fantasy. And so that's... and it's got a special place in my heart, that particular game.
Speaking of, there's this other game that maybe you'd be interested in for the same reason that they recently announced. Have y'all heard of Toy Soldiers War Chest?
I love the Toy Soldiers series.
Okay. I've never even heard of the Toy Soldier series, but apparently there's a new one coming called War Chest, and it's already been confirmed to have both He-Man and G.I. Joe toys in it.
You're kidding!
Yeah,
oh,
there's,
cool
they released
that.
Some pictures earlier today.
Is this kind of like not Disney Infinity, or
no.
is it heading that direction?
Well, no. It's like they have their own little toys as well.
Oh, okay.
But when I looked at the graphics, it looked pretty neat. It really did look like little toys with like little... you know, sectioned points, articulation mm-hmm. points.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
And the He-Man and Battle Cat figures looked really good. I didn't see any of the
nice.
G.I. Joe figures, but...
And I guess I should probably say something about Battlefront as well.
Sure.
Because...
Star Wars?
Yeah. I was always a Battlefront fan. I enjoyed mm-hmm. Battlefront 2. Back when Star Wars Minis was a thing, and if you're not sure what that is, you know, look it up. hit Board Game Geek or something. But if you do know what that is, then that probably means you're old, because they stopped selling them about 10 years ago. But the actual Star Wars Mini D20 game, we created a variant, which was Battlefront, and it had objectives and things like that. Mm-hmm. It's pretty awesome. So
I'm curious to see what they do with Battlefront, because I was really intrigued by some of the concepts behind the original Star Wars Battlefront.
Oh, yeah.
And then when I saw it in play, I was underwhelmed.
Oh, really?
So I'm curious to see what changes they make. It sounds like it's basically going to be, in a way, you know, Star Wars Battlefield. They're just calling it Battlefront. But it'll be interesting to see where it does differ, if at all, from Battlefield, and kind of what they're able to do to... build on the series. So,
well, technically, you're probably not wrong there.
Yeah.
Was that the one? Which one was the one that was on like PSP? Was that Battlefield or Battlefront?
Probably Battlefront.
That's the only one I ever played, mm-hmm. and I didn't play it for very long because mm-hmm. it came with, when I got a PSP, it was bundled with it, and that was the only one I ever played, and it didn't really grab me. But I know there was another Star Wars series that was like a real-time strategy game?
Mm-hmm.
Is that the one that you're talking about, or is that a different one?
No, there's a few Star Wars RTSs. One was something, I forget, Empire something, or something Empire.
Empire Builder?
No.
Well, there was one that I want to say was I don't know if it was based on the same engine, but it looked a lot like Sins of the Solar Empire, but I don't know if it was the same engine or if it was just had a similar name. Oh, you know what it was? It was Star Wars Empire War.
That's what it was.
Yeah, I just remembered that.
And then there was also a basically a Star Wars version of, what's the name of the game?
You're talking about the mobile?
No, the medieval RTS. Something Kings.
Crusader Kings?
No, not Crusader Kings.
Age of Empires?
Age of Empires, yes. It was basically Age of Empires engine, but with Star Wars.
Right.
Which was... It was cool for me when I was a tween playing it, so... I don't know if I'd feel the same way about it if I went back to it now, but...
Yeah, fair enough.
By the way, EA, I'm still waiting for Criterion's version of Podracers. I'm going to say that anytime I think of EA and Star Wars, so just like reminding you that that's a thing that needs to happen. Thank you.
Was that the only good thing to come out of Phantom Menace? The Podracing in 64
game? I would argue that the lightsaber battles were cool, too. But
some of that flippy stuff I didn't really like that much. I will say that the music was great,
as usual.
New songs were great, but I mean, that's John Williams, so he's never going to disappoint.
Mm-hmm.
Unlike George.
George Lucas.
Oh, I'm on a first name basis with him.
This Week in Gaming History.
So this week we have a new segment, This Week in Gaming History. So anytime we think that there's something that comes up that has happened at some point in gaming history within this week or this past week, we're going to just talk about it for just a few moments.
Gaming history.
Gaming history,
what
yes.
What a notion.
Mm-hmm.
Are we that old? Are we really that old?
We are that old.
We're getting there. Yeah.
We're there.
Okay.
So the first one I do want to bring up is Tetris, and it came out in 1984 this past Saturday. This was a game that was designed by Alexei Pachinov in the Soviet Union. So obviously everyone knows Tetris. I don't know if there's... At this point, I'm not sure there's anyone alive that hasn't played Tetris. It is one of the most well-known games mm-hmm. of all time. So it is definitely something that is worth talking about. I assume both of y'all have played Tetris in some form.
Of course.
So just quick, going around the table, what is your favorite version of Tetris, Chris?
I think, actually, the version I played the most is probably still my favorite just because I played it the most. Mm-hmm. It was one that was on my flip phone.
Okay.
Not even my smartphone.
That's fair.
I used to play it on the bus all the time.
Okay. And extra question that put you on the spot. Why was it your favorite? Is it just because you played it the most?
This is the one I played the most, yeah.
Any controls that you thought were better?
It controlled well enough.
Or smoother? Okay.
I also liked the version I played on my smartphone when smartphone games were a new thing. That version of Tetris is pretty cool, too. But I don't know, I think just the first one I really played a lot kind of holds that special place in my heart.
Cool. Doc, what about you?
Well, the PS3 version that came out not too long ago, I think it was called like Tetris Next or something like that. I don't even remember what it was called, honestly. I enjoyed that one quite a bit because it gave you the option to unlock variants of Tetris as you went along, and it also had the classic pure version of Tetris as well. But the temptation to new thing and new version and I've got challenges and let's do challenge mode was too great for me. I couldn't stay focused. So the answer to my question or to your question is actually the original 8-bit Nintendo Tetris, where whenever you beat a level, Link was like playing on his fiddle at the end.
Yeah.
And then if it was a higher level, then you know Samus was there. And if it was a higher level, then Donkey Kong was there. And if it was a higher level, Mario was there. And finally, you're trying to get the rocket to go. It was like the space shuttle, I think, to go up if you could actually beat the thing. And the reason why is because that was before other versions of Tetris existed. That's before Tetris 2 with its breakable blocks and Tetris 3 with its such and such and Tetris, who knows what it's even called, with its, you know, quad types and...
Yeah, there was like this... What was it? I know there was like a Tetris Attack and maybe that was Tetris 2.
The Versus version.
There was
all that stuff.
And there was like what was it called? Like Tetris Sphere or like something like that was on, I think, the PS2 where it was like a 3D version of Tetris.
I don't think I ever played that version.
It was terrible.
How was it?
It was pretty bad.
But, back in the original days, this was even before Game Boy, which is a close second for me, there was no cheat. There was no other mode. You had fast, faster, and fastest, and that was it.
Yeah.
And there was garbage at the bottom, and you tried to get the garbage off. And so if you were trying to beat it level 18 with all the garbage at the bottom, your brain just had to go. And I swear, I think that playing hours and hours and hours and hours of that stuff was rewiring people's brains. I think there's probably studies to prove this, because I know it was messing with mine. You know, I'd be in the back seat of the car, and I'd look up from my Game Boy, and I would see tetrads falling between buildings and stuff.
I had the same experience.
We all did if we played enough.
And that was my favorite of the, version of the game, actually.
The 8-bit version?
The Game Boy version, actually.
The Game Boy
version,
because
that's the one I had the most experience with, that I played the most. Put so many hours into it, almost broke my Game Boy.
Yeah.
But moving on.
$100 a battery.
Yes. The other game that I did want to mention was Link's Awakening, which was the Game Boy, original Game Boy version. Another game that I almost broke my Game Boy for, just from playing it so much. I did take a few notes here about the game. It was actually directed by Takashi Tezuka, not Miyamoto. Miyamoto was just the producer.
Really? I didn't know that.
But Tezuka actually also was the original script writer and story writer for the first Legend of Zelda and Zelda 2. So he had a long history of working with Miyamoto. But yeah, this was actually my one of my favorite Legend of Zelda games, just because it did sort of break from the mold. You weren't really in Hyrule, you were in this dream world. I really loved the way the sort of like I don't want to say Lost style. This was before Lost, but it had that sort of like twist ending to it that I thought was really neat, and you sort of had this like bittersweet you save the day, but not really aspect. I almost don't want to spoil it for people, because for me, that was my first, like, aha moment in games.
It's 30 years old. I think they don't have any excuses at this point.
This is the Mobile Minute, where we share something new or noteworthy about those computers we keep in our pants.
So yeah, this week's Mobile Minute is actually about a surprising game. It's a free game that I discovered as a byproduct of the aforementioned games that I bought on Craigslist. One of the games that I actually discovered was called Summoner Wars. And it turns out that one of the great ways to learn how to play Summoner Wars is to download the free app. So basically, Summoner Wars is you are a summoner. It's a two-player game. But the most interesting aspect about this card game is that the grid, which is basically an 8x6 grid, you have a 4x6 grid and your opponent has a 4x6 grid. You actually place the cards out as you would deploy, say, units in a miniatures game. And one of the units is walls. You can actually hide behind walls. There are event cards, which include the spells that you would actually put out, and then of course the units themselves. And there's a little bit of lore that goes into it. It's your sort of stock fantasy so-and-so, and it really doesn't matter. But it has orcs, and that's what I care about. And so that is, to me, the redeeming quality of this actually really fun game with lots of collectible cards and armies that you can go out and buy, either analog or digital. And that's the Mobile Minute.
Okay, so our main topic for today that we're going to be talking about is... Reboot. Reboot. I didn't like that. I was the way I said it.
Oh, I gotcha.
But yeah, so the topic for today is our reboots in video games. Something that I'm not really a big fan of. I'm not a fan of reboots, especially for movies. I think in video games you can get away with reboots a little better, just because you can change the mechanics enough that it comes across as a unique experience that might have, you know, its own sort of value to it, as opposed to just the story itself, a narrative reboot, as it were. We were talking a little bit about this before we started recording, Doc, where I was sort of questioning a reboot between the mechanic reboot and a narrative reboot.
Yeah, we kind of need to
What is a reboot? What is a remake? What is a
remaster? The other one, because that keeps coming out. There's a lot of these games that keep coming out. Like, I know Last of Us. There's Last of Us Remaster.
Yeah, let's start there, actually, because I think that there's some great examples of remastered games that have come out recently. You know, we talk a lot about 8-bit versus 16-bit versus this and that versus high definition versus whatever. Monkey Island, I think, is one of the great examples of a well-remastered game. A couple years back, it came out, and then the second one came out after that.
Right.
And I think it's brilliant. There's actually a way that you can hit, when it was PS3, it was the select button. And you could just hit the select button, it would turn it off, and you were then playing in the old mode.
Right.
And the sound went away, because they recorded new sounds.
Yeah, it was like orchestral.
Yeah, it was very gorgeous.
It was very nice, and the art style sort of took on this sort of like cartoonish.
Absolutely,
It's kind of like that Halo game that came out not too long ago, where you could like be playing Halo 1, and there's like the HD version, and then you can toggle the old graphics.
Which is amazing to me that Halo is old enough to have been deserving of a reboot, but of course that was two generations ago.
No, hold on. It's also Microsoft.
Was that a reboot or a remaster?
No, I think that was a remaster.
Okay.
I think it clearly was. And anytime you take, this would be my definition, anytime you take the original content and then you just reskin it with minor tweaks, I think that that is just a remastering, as you would with a film or something like that. So
I think they also like made full 3D like cinematics for the cutscenes. So what used to just be a cutscene in engine would now be a cinematic video.
Oh, for Halo?
Yeah.
Well, I'm not a huge Halo fan.
I'm not either.
It wasn't fast enough for me. Was my problem. Mm. So,
I used to pour hours and hours with friends of mine on a split screen on the old Xbox.
So, oh, sure.
Fun memories of Halo, I have to say.
Yeah, we did the same thing. It was just with Quake 3 and Doom 2. So.
Doom 2, yeah.
Yeah.
That was a great one.
Yeah, Doom 2 was the 64 for us, and then the Dreamcast was our Quake 3.
So, speaking specifically of... I lost my train of thought. We were talking about Halo.
Reboots.
I know, but we were talking about Halo. I don't remember. Go ahead.
Well, has there been a reboot of Halo?
I don't think so. No.
Yeah, there was. It was called Destiny, right?
Well, there... I don't know.
I'm going to get in trouble for that one.
Yeah.
There have been spinoffs, and of course, spinoffs is a totally different topic.
Yeah.
Oh, I know what I was going to ask about, too. Specifically, Metal Gear Solid, the Twin Snakes. Is that considered a reboot?
Ooh, that's a good question. That's not a reboot.
Oh, I will go on record and saying that I like the Twin Snakes.
Oh, yeah.
Damn it.
I liked it.
Some people didn't like it.
That's how I played MGS1. I've never actually played the original.
It's a more over-the-top version of it, but I think it actually fits in a little better with what Kojima might have wanted it to be.
I called that a remaster, not a reboot.
Really? Because they changed the story a little bit.
A little bit, but I don't think it's
And
enough.
The mechanics are actually very changed. I think it's a reboot.
I'll get into kind of like what I think a reboot is later, but I think that... They added the stuff, like basically they put it into the MGS2 engine.
Exactly.
Which I don't think is a reboot. I think it's maybe a remake. I would maybe not a remaster, but a remake. So
is this the George Lucas definition of re-release? Is that what we're really talking about?
It sounds like we are really at this point.
But you see, that's...
Han shot first.
Yeah,
you're wrong, George. Get
over it. Never mind that it's your IP and it's an independent film and that you're... Yeah, whatever.
No, George, he doesn't get to decide. Once you put something out there, it's the audience that decides. It becomes owned by everyone.
Yeah, that is an interesting thing. Is like, to what degree does an author have the right to retcon stuff?
I say, and my opinion on that is none. Mm. Absolutely none.
Once it's published, that's when you reboot your own franchise
and
do it differently.
Yeah.
You can reboot it if you want, but it doesn't erase what previously happened.
I would love to see a Star Wars reboot done...
Not by George Lucas?
It won't happen until after he dies, for starters, but done in the original concept art. If you look at the original concept art...
The Ralph McQuarrie?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Oh, that stuff is brilliant. And if it was done like that, in that style that feels almost 1950s Futurama style, that would be absolutely fantastic, I think. I think you could tell those stories again, and they'd almost be unrecognizable, even if you used pretty much the same dialogue, which you shouldn't. But but I think they'd be almost unrecognizable because the setting would be fundamentally altered.
Didn't they try to do that with the... It was a comic book, but it was, and it is transmedia. It was the Star Killer. Did you ever read that story?
Oh, yeah, yeah. It was kind of his original...
George Lucas's original idea for Star Wars.
Yeah,
where
but
he
you
had,
know, just because...
Which,
you...
by the way, terrible.
Yeah.
It's a terrible story. But I think they actually based a lot of the ship designs and stuff off of some of that concept art from McQuarrie. So
actually, that I think rings true. Mm-hmm. So, in terms of style and that kind of thing, I can see it. But... All of that is leading back to the main question, which is, what is a reboot? And so I would ask you guys, challenge you guys, to think of solid examples of what is definitely a reboot in video games.
Okay, so the Devil May Cry series, DMC, when that came out, I call that a reboot.
Yeah.
I would also say Prince of...
Because that changed canon story, right?
It changed canon story. Like, it is something that, and I think this might be toward a definition here, is that it's the same... premise of the story,
yes,
reimagined,
and also the same genre from a mechanic standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
It was the same. It was an action game.
So then, but every Final Fantasy that doesn't have the word 2 after it, except for Final Fantasy 2, is sort of a reboot.
Yes.
I would say so.
I think so, yes. That's a good example. And I think, I know you wanted to talk Prince of Persia, and I think both Sands of Time and the 2008 one are both reboots.
Yeah, definitely.
Because the original Prince of Persia was the side-scroller, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Like the old school one. Yes. So.
But they're all...
Which also had its own remaster.
Yes.
In HD with 3D.
It did, actually.
It did. But they're both... They're all of them. All those are action-adventure games. Mm-hmm. It's just that they did change. And I think, you know, I agree with you that, yes, you know, the narrative reboot is a part of it. But I do think that there's also that mechanics reboot. We are talking about games, the interactivity, and the changes that you can have. Like, if you compare Tomb Raider is another example of a reboot.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't just, you know, the storyline itself that was different. It was also the way that you played the game. The mechanics were different.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I actually didn't like that game, but it was different from the original. The original was a lot more freewheeling action. This one tried to be more of a, at least initially, took on more of like a somber tone and tried to sort of be a little bit more real with its violence, which works at first until she just starts killing people willy-nilly as though she didn't really care. Right? I mean, it's like she has this whole thing where it's like, oh no, I killed someone, how terrible, and all this. And then very quickly, it doesn't matter. You're just killing people nonstop. And you have this huge disconnect between the story and the mechanics that doesn't work for
you. You know what would have been interesting in that game? Not to sidetrack us too much, but in MGS4, there was a mechanic where you had a psych level. It was basically your combat stress. Uh-huh. And if it got too high, basically if you're playing too run and gun, you would actually start to have combat sickness where he would grow weary and maybe even nauseous.
Really?
You'd have to like stop and rest and stuff in order to get your stamina back, which part of it was his age.
Which Metal Gear was it?
Metal Gear Solid 4.
Mm. Oh yeah, that's the one that came shipped with my PS3.
It would have been interesting,
about
15
minutes of it.
In Tomb Raider, if like, you know, because you can sort of in a way explain that away, because it's like, oh well, she had to like sort of steel her nerves and the first kill's really hard, but then she gets used to it or pushes through it or whatever. Uh-huh. But what would have been interesting is if you kill too many people too quickly, you start to have kind of a combat stress sort of situation where you have to, like, you're sort of crippled until you recover and sort of get your mind back together.
Sounds to me like more games need that mechanic.
I like that, but I also think that in Tomb Raider in particular, it should have been a situation where you're actively trying not to kill people. You should be, like, you're in a situation, you're trying to get, like, for a lot of us have that experience of playing Metal Gear Solid that way, where we try not to kill someone, we try to, like, sneak past them, or really, I think, because she was in survival mode, it should have almost been played more like, you know, a tactical stealth type game, mm-hmm. as opposed to just straight up action.
And I think if I remember correctly, it has one of those moments that I also remember Uncharted 2 had, I believe it was, mm-hmm. maybe Uncharted 3.
Neither of those reboots.
Those are sequels.
Okay.
But
I don't even know what a reboot is.
Unless they're reboots of Indiana Jones under a different name. I think they have this moment too where the villain, like toward the end, you're nearing the final confrontation, it's like, am I really so evil? You've killed over 300 people. It's like, yeah, well, you, the writer, the developer behind this, set that up for me. You didn't give me much of a choice. So,
right. There is that element,
so
too.
It's always kind of funny whenever, like, they sort of, like, put this moment of, like, you know, questioning the morality of what you're doing in this game. It's like, the game didn't really give me any options, you know? So, it seems a little bit odd to do that. But, anyway.
They're trying to be clever.
Yeah.
And it's not working for you.
No.
Anyway. I agree. It does annoy me, too. but yeah, so I'm still honestly a little bit confused about what we're counting. What is a reboot?
I think. Okay, well, let's go with some.
You want to change the story? You want to reboot the story, but it also the mechanics. So because Twin Snakes for me, I would say, I guess the difference, maybe we could say that why Twin Snakes may not be a reboot, even though it did change both the mechanics and the story.
Tweaked the story. I wouldn't say reimagine the story entirely.
No, but I don't know if that's necessarily a requirement. But I do think that it didn't continue from there.
Mm.
You know, like, it was sort of like a side thing. They didn't go for the next Metal Gear. They didn't say, well, the previous version didn't really happen that way, and this is now the established canon version of Metal Gear Solid. They didn't really do that.
I don't know if there was anything...
side story, right?
Yeah, I don't know if there's anything important to the canon that they changed between MGS1 and Twin Snakes. I mean, maybe I just didn't play enough MGS1
presentation-wise, they did. The way that the story was presented was very different. It had a much more... over-the-top action-y, Mission Impossible 2, that kind of, like, feel to it. Mm-hmm. Like, Bad Boys, you know, very that style
of
action. But
it doesn't change the core of the story, like, the plot of what happens, which you go into Stop Metal Gear, and your brother is, you know, your twin, and all this different
stuff.
Yes,
but that's stripping out the essence of the story, in terms of the way that the story is told, and the theme, and the tone, I should really say, the tone of the story, was different.
So I think then we might actually be, again, approaching kind of another definition point, which I think a reboot isn't just changing the presentation, but again, it can actually change the narrative quite significantly, change the plot quite significantly. It's a reimagining of the same premise, which is to say...
But that's what I'm saying is not a reboot, though. See, I'm saying that's not. I'm saying Twin Snakes is really a remake.
We agree.
Right. But it's not a reboot because they didn't continue the series in that vein. The same thing with another Metal Gear does this all the time, actually, now that I think about it. The Game Boy Color Metal Gear Solid, known as Ghost Babel, was, I think, only in Japan, but most people call it Ghost Babel here now anyway, was essentially another side story. It was a, what if after the first Metal Gear Solid, this story happens? Mm-hmm. And so it was sort of like almost a, like, a B timeline. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like a Back to the Future style.
You see, I don't think I would call...
And that wasn't really a remake either.
A
reboot. Maybe that was a reboot.
You can maybe call it a spinoff. You can call it kind of like the timeline B, the non-canon sort of thing. But I think Twin Snakes was close enough to MGS1 that I don't consider it a side story. Like, is it in my canon? Because I only played that one. And maybe this isn't officially canon or whatever. But, I mean, MGS Twin Snakes is MGS1. For all intents and purposes. Even if it's presented slightly differently, it's got the same story.
Well,
the same stuff happens.
One of the big examples that people like to bring up is the whole, like, torture scene and trying to keep Meryl alive, which was made significantly easier in Twin Snakes. It was the sort of thing where the experience that most gamers had with the original Metal Gear Solid was she dies. Because it's made to the point where, kind of intentionally, that you're just not going to be able to button mash well enough in order to save Meryl unless you have a special controller, sort
the
hacky
fire thing.
Right. But in Twin Snakes, it's actually quite doable, quite easy to save her. But canon story-wise, she is saved. So could you make the argument that, you know, that is the story, because in the story, they wanted Meryl to be saved by Snake, but most of the gamers didn't have that experience in the original version. So Twin Snakes sort of came along and made sure they did. So in a sense, from like in the mechanics, they kind of almost fixed that.
I mean, I think the intention always was that if you play the game ideally, that's going to be the canon ending. Because you're always going to pick a canon ending in any sort of branching game.
Right.
So, you know, I don't think changing the difficulty changes whether or not the story is the same.
But it changes the experience. It changes the player story, the way the player views the story, because you really can't beat it. I mean, I would challenge you to find someone that could beat it legitimately.
Well, then we get into a weird discussion about, like, can games ever have a canon if it's all about player experience? Which I think is kind of getting a little bit too far away.
No, I get what you're saying about canon, but my point is that the player experience was very different between Metal Gear Solid 1 and Twin Snakes.
But I still don't think it's a reboot.
I'm not necessarily calling it a reboot. I'm just saying that it's an important distinction to make, that the player experience being different does... I think that there's more... I want to move away from this idea that because of the narrative of MGS is a certain way, because the story is a certain way, therefore that is the way that players are experiencing it, because that's not true. You know, if you make a game, unless it's 100% on rails, in which case I would argue it's not even really a game at that point, but unless it's 100% on rails, you're not necessarily going to be experiencing the story the same exact way that someone else is. There's going to be a difference there. So I don't want to say right off the bat where this is a remake because the story has been changed, and that's really all that matters. And
I will say that...
Player experience matters.
Maybe what we're kind of debating here
mechanics
is...
matter.
If we're sort of trying to decide, and I think we've already kind of agreed on this to an extent, but if Twin Snakes, whether that's a remaster or a remake, definitely a remake. It's not a remaster because it does play differently.
And I would say, I'm going to throw another word in there. A reimagining. And I think that, I think that fits a little better because it is a reimagining. Well, let me tell you why. Because it's taking the story of Metal Gear Solid, which was presented in a more somber, gritty, realistic tone. Even though it does have those elements of Twin Snakes, it also throws in those Mission Impossible 2, Bad Boys, like over-the-top action-style cutscenes that sort of juxtapose with that somber, the somber storyline that's going on in the background. So it's sort of reimagining that story in a different, and presenting it to you in a different way from like a tone perspective. Totally. So I would say it is a reimagining.
You see, for me, reimagining is cutting too close to reboot.
No, because I think see, for me, reimagining is like really just taking the story and then just twisting it slightly.
I think I see where you're going.
Whereas a reboot is much like you turn it a dial. I think we just disagree. You turn it 360 degrees.
Yeah, I think we just disagree on what's the word I'm looking for? Not syntax, but we're getting into semantics.
Yeah.
Semantics, like we're debating like which word ought to be used. I do see your point though.
I don't know. To me, the idea of a reimagining seems more like AU stuff, alternate universe, right? The title of it's not coming to me. What's that game where the Disney characters meet up with all the Final Fantasy characters?
Kingdom Hearts.
That's a crossover.
That's
cool. Oh goodness!
That is impossible. It is.
Forget I said anything.
Wait a minute. See,
I get two wrenches for your work stuff here. Okay, so the first one would be Minecraft. Mm-hmm. Been playing Minecraft since Alpha, and big supporter and big fan of the Let's Plays, Yogscast, Shin's my buddy, you know, that kind of thing. But what about games like that have an open Alpha and then an open Beta and then after that official launch, keep making changes every couple of months to core content.
Yeah, MMOs are the same thing. World of Warcraft has gone through quite a few changes.
Fair enough. But at least that, everything that's happened in there has been canon, and there is a story and that sort of a thing. Minecraft has no real story, and it doesn't even arguably have an end, although someone could argue.
I'm not even sure I would count Minecraft as a game, to be honest with you.
Okay.
But maybe that's mincing.
You know what? I've made that argument before. I made it in class for years. But I guess my question is that just an ongoing development game, and it doesn't qualify for reimagining or rebooting or anything like that? You can't play Minecraft Alpha anymore. You really can't.
I mean, I wouldn't say that Minecraft has ever been rebooted.
That's just iteration, versioning.
Yeah.
Versioning? Okay.
Yeah. But I think that, like, to get into reboot territory, remake territory, it has to be another release.
Gotcha.
And not an update to an existing release.
Okay, so then that leads to my second wrench, which is the Stanley Parable, which was extreme indie. Not even, you could download the thing, it was free, it was an experimental game, and then it went to Steam, and then you could pay for it, and then it had extra content. What does that qualify for?
That's a good question. That one, I don't know how much was different between the original Stanley Parable and the other one.
Oh, lots, about five times the original content.
That one, I don't know if that's quite a reboot, but I think that's a candidate for calling it a reboot.
A remake?
A remake, certainly, if not a reboot.
Maybe like an expanded remake?
Yeah. Because I think a remake is allowed to
have... An expanded remake with some reimagining.
There you go.
Reimagined remake.
We're getting way too granular with this.
I've actually not even played Stanley Parable.
But like,
I don't even know.
Let's take a look, for instance, at film. Just kind of get like that comparison.
But see, that's where... And it's a lot easier to spot in film, because there's more elements. That's why I want to move away from film. And I'm someone... I like movies, and I'm into that. But it's just... With movies, you're looking at... the story, and if the story, if they change the story enough, you can go, okay, reboot. Mm-hmm. But in games, there's so many other elements to it. It's not just about the director's story. Mm-hmm. It's about also the player experience, and it's also about the mechanics. So there's three different things going on. It's not just the designer's story.
Mm-hmm. Well, okay, so because I was going to make I forget even what the point was with the movie. It was basically going to have to do with what would you consider like a remake in a film versus a reboot, and a lot of it is narrative. It could also argue, though, that even if you want to call it the mechanics of the film, like, for instance, how action plays out is going to be very different in a reboot.
Right.
And I think you can sort of make that same comparison in gaming if you want to look at Devil May Cry, for example. I think that in the original series, there was probably an expectation that was built up for how it ought to play.
Mm-hmm.
And that kind of like sort of became fixed the further it went along. I haven't played a lot of Devil May Cry, so I'm not an expert in it, but just watching gameplay footage and stuff, this is my impression. The DMC, the reboot, it was like a different version of the main character, reimagining of the main character. It was... kind of like the same sort of premise of like you've got like this shadow world and you're kind of like going into that and whatever.
Mm-hmm. Pretty different story. I mean, like, it, the base concept was the same, but yeah, the story was very different.
Yeah, and I think that's a big part of it. But also, I imagine mechanically, there are also some differences as well, where it's the same genre, as you said earlier. It's the same genre of gameplay, mechanically speaking, but they have a different approach to, they're allowed to change the feel or change like how it is you're going about the action
Definitely.
In the game.
I think what annoyed me with DMC, which I did not like, and I had played the earlier Devil May Cry games and enjoyed them, and to me, I just didn't like the new Dante, and it felt different enough to me that I'd kind of wish that they had just called it something else and not tried to connect it to Devil May Cry. I feel that way, honestly, about Tomb Raider. I feel like they just sort of used that name as a way to cash in on an established, one of the most well-established franchises in gaming. Tomb Raider is a pretty big franchise. And really, they were telling a very different story. And they had very different, you know, approach to how they were telling that story. And so I don't really see why it had to be Tomb Raider.
I think it's, and you know, some of it is, of course, the name recognition.
I think that's all it was, quite honestly.
But
in both cases, by the way.
I could also see, too, though, that in a way you've got this IP and this character who's like iconic in the gaming world of, you know, Lara Croft. And you're wanting to sort of reimagine her character for a more modern audience, more modern sensibility, and kind of give her this origin story and that sort of thing. That, I mean, I don't know if the developers, they probably have spoken to whether or not this is meant to fit in with the other games, or if it's meant to be like the beginning of a new version of Tomb Raider. But, you know, I think that there's nothing inherently wrong if you feel like you want to sort of remake a character for a new audience, a new generation. That's not inherently a bad thing.
But what's wrong with just creating a new character?
There's nothing wrong with it.
So I think I don't see the advantage of like creating a new version of a character.
Because they're a stock character. Yeah. And a stock character is known. I mean, whenever we look at God of War, Kratos, right? And we're like, he's the God of War. I know him. I know exactly who he is. And Link, man, there's nobody else like Link. Mm-hmm. You can't create a new Link.
Well, but see, I don't think that they need to, because the Legend of Zelda games have retained that tone. I mean, they've made some mechanics changes. And I guess really, I guess that's a big thing that I think is connecting a lot of these games and sort of keeps them from the reboot, is this concept of tone and feel, you know, just like that's a big part of gaming, to me at least, and how I'm able to experience that story. So I think with Legend of Zelda, even though each game is, that's another series where, to me, each game feels like it's almost rebooting the concept. I mean, there's a couple of examples that are direct sequels, but I never really bought into the Zelda timeline. For me, it was always just a new way to tell that same legend.
I think it was a gimmick to sell the book, honestly.
I think so, too. I don't think Miyamoto ever really felt that they were meant to be this, like, convoluted timeline.
And I've mentioned this before, that, like, I think that there were times, too, or even before they had the all-connecting timeline, that, like, you knew that Majora's Mask was a direct sequel to Ocarina of Time.
Right. Well, Zelda 2 was a direct sequel to the first one.
Yeah, exactly. Link's Awakening, there are ones that were meant to be connected. But, yeah, I mean, Zelda's another one of those ones where, you know, in the same way that you could argue for Final Fantasy, that it's a reimagining of the core premise, Legend of Zelda might be the same thing.
Well, maybe with Legend of Zelda, it's a reimagining of the core premise, but with Final Fantasy, it's a straight-up reboot of everything. Because you look at Final Fantasy and Final Fantasy II, and the difference is not just in story. Toss out story if you want to. The mechanics are totally different. The classes are totally different. The way the world is laid out is totally different. The sort of races that are in the world are totally different. The original Final Fantasy had dwarves and elves. Like, that's... I mean, were there dwarves and elves in Final Fantasy VII? They didn't even exist.
You're saying that as a good thing or a bad thing?
It's a neutral. It's just an observation.
Oh, okay.
I'm pointing out that
yeah,
these
each,
are
each
these
Final
are
Fantasy
very,
kind
very
of
different.
Exists in its own universe.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so that's why I think with Final Fantasy you really can say. I mean, there's some that you could argue are in the same world, especially when you start getting into, the Ivalice collection. Where later on you had Final Fantasy Tactics within that world, and then you had Final Fantasy XII, and then Final Fantasy XIV, the MMO. And I want to say that the new MMO, what is it, 17 or 16? Or
14.
I lose track. Oh, 11 and 14, I'm sorry. So yeah, 11 and 14 were both in that same world, right, Ivalice?
That I don't know.
I know 11 was. Mm-hmm. So I'm pretty sure 14 was too. So yeah, you have that sort of a connection, but most of them were not. I think there was also in Final Fantasy IX. Did either of y'all play Final Fantasy IX?
I've played very little of it.
Have I played more than a couple of hours of any Final Fantasy?
Oh, okay. No. So there were some like suggestions that it was connected to the first mm-hmm. Final Fantasy. Mm-hmm. With the way that some of the fiends were laid out, mm-hmm. and things like that. So yeah, there's a few connections here and there that feel like that maybe they're connected, but that's a series where I think you could argue that each one is almost its own sort of reboot.
So here's another reword maybe to throw into the mix.
Yes.
Remix.
Okay, yes, I
and
love it.
I wonder if maybe Final Fantasy I would call more a remix of a concept.
Okay.
Because they never...
I like it.
We've established that like that each one is its own... story, and I think it's like a remix
and
on,
world. It's yeah, own story. It's own it's world. Own, it's own.
Whereas a reboot, I think, almost has to have a certain degree of similarity to what it is that's remaking, because none of the Final Fantasies is trying to remake the last.
That's true.
That's also true.
Yeah, a reboot is trying to remake in its own way. If you want to say that. So maybe
a reboot is a remake. So, that's reimagined.
I think The Legend of Zelda 2 would be another candidate for remix. Even though it's more similar than Final Fantasies tend to be, you're remixing The Legend of Zelda, which is, you know, the Triforce and Zelda and Link and Ganon and the relationship between those three, you know, archetypes and how they relate to each of the three pieces of the Triforce and all the different stuff. That's kind of like the myth. I'm trying to think of the word. The
legend?
Well, the legend, yes. The
Zelda?
Yes.
No, but
there's a term I'm looking for very specifically. That's
mythos.
It's the before myth, the ermyth. Is that what I'm looking for?
The mythology.
Hang on, I'm gonna look this up. You guys keep talking.
Yeah, I mean, what about those Legend of Zelda games though? That sort of back away from the concept of Princess Zelda and Ganon and the Triforce.
Yeah, she's almost a minor character. Well, they all of them, really.
No, but the ones that move away from that entirely. Like, for example, Link's Awakening, like we brought up today. You're in a different... We are not in Hyrule. There is no Ganon. And you have a different love interest. Marin has nothing... And she actually is presented as a love interest, unlike Zelda, who very rarely is presented as a love interest, actually. She's just presented as a princess that you're, or like queen, mm-hmm. or... bandit or whatever she is in that particular game that you're trying to help, mm-hmm. Or freedom fighter, what have you. Mm-hmm. But Marin is presented as an actual love interest. Mm-hmm. So because the whole game is played out almost like it's Link's dream world. Mm-hmm. It's arguable. Yeah. So he actually gets the girl this time. So but this was pretty. It's another cool thing that I thought they sort of played up mm-hmm. in that game.
It was the ermyth is the term I was looking for. You okay. are. It's combining form original primitive is the meaning. So kind of like if it was the original myth from which all the other myths spawned. And, you know, that's one of the things in myth studies is people try to look for the ermyths of a given culture.
Right. And I think it feels to me, and that's a great point to bring up too, because I think for many of the Legend of Zelda games, it feels like they're building off of, they're giving their own sort of take on an ermyth that we've never been told. Like, we don't know what it is. But they're all giving their own take
I
on
like
it.
That, yeah.
But not all of them, but that's what I'm saying. There's those exceptions, so where do they fit in? Like, like Link's Awakening, when you're in a different world, you don't have Ganon, you don't have Zelda, or for example, the Oracle games, Oracle of Ages, Oracle of Seasons, Four Sword Adventures. Mm-hmm. So you've got these one, Four Sword Adventures I think actually do technically fight Ganon at the end. But what was that one? Oh, Minish Cap, where you have Vati. Mm-hmm. As sort of the villain, it takes place in different. So you've got these different where they sort of divorce themselves from that myth, and normally those are the ones that are like often called sequels to a previous
to something. Yeah.
Majora's Mask also fits into that same sort of mold where you they sort of move away from the Triforce and the Princess, like that sort of like the word escapes me, where it's like the three way connection between the characters Ganon. Ganon, Zelda, and Link. I forget the
term. Yeah, it's my term.
The triumvirate,
but that's more a ruling term.
Yeah.
We'll edit this to make ourselves
the trifecta.
There we go.
Well, maybe I don't know if that's right either.
Just Chris.
Anyway,
post-edit it so that we all sound so much smarter and on the ball.
But we're going to be talking. It's like that one relationship between Zelda and Ganon.
You'll make it perfectly seamless.
The love triangle? No.
But yeah,
that's what it was.
The love triforce.
So what do we call those games that do sort of step away from that concept? Are those not really that remix concept? They're not really building off of that ermyth. as it were.
Actually, that's exactly what I'd call them. I call them remixes.
So you would call, but then how are those a remix, but also the ones, for example, like the first Legend of Zelda and Link to the Past, which are
so
sort of almost like retelling. It's another reword. It's a retelling of the story. So
maybe...
And the world, too, because Hyrule's different in these as well. So the way that Hyrule's laid out is different, too.
I think that whenever you do a reboot, you're trying to essentially tell the same story again in a new way, meant to be like, this is...
I love how I've taken this discussion in this direction. I love this.
This is why we're going, like, from here we are moving forward. We're ignoring everything else.
Right.
This is its own thing, and it's moving forward. With The Legend of Zelda, we have the remixes of that Urmith.
Uh-huh.
And then I think, too, that you can sort of say the ones like, you know, Minish Cap and all that different stuff, I don't think are quite spin-offs.
Because they're definitely not spin-offs. They're part of the main series. Yeah.
Some of them are prequels. Some of them are sequels.
Yeah.
Some of them are, I mean... In a way, you can kind of argue that mechanically, too, Legend of Zelda has a certain...
there's definitely a connection
of the mechanics.
Yeah,
You know,
Very true.
Go to dungeons, collect enough of these things, beat the final boss. So maybe in that way, games have one more avenue through which they can call it part of the series rather than a reboot, whereas films don't have that luxury.
Yeah, that's a good point. And I think with films, you could almost do that. If they reuse like the same world, you could sort of draw maybe that connection there.
Well, like the Ewok movie?
Yes. The Ewok movies, there were two of them.
The Christmas special. That's
true,
actually, yeah. Well, one was called The Battle for Endor, so...
Yes, that's true. I just remember them as, like, the Ewok adventure movies.
Yeah. Poor Sindel, her whole family.
There were some dark scenes in that show for a kid watching that when I was young, you know?
It was darker than Empire in many ways. Or Jedi, in many ways.
The young girl gets saved by the creepy old man. I just remember always being, like, weirded out by that, where it was like... The young girl gets saved by that creepy old guy.
Oh, yeah.
Who's like lives in the forest. And
that was the second one, yeah. We find out there's really giants on Endor.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So maybe this is kind of the question of the week to people that I'll mention in the close. But so what terms ought we to use? What rewords do we need?
Let's go over them, right? We've got the reboot, the remix,
the remake, the remaster,
remaster.
The reworking.
Reimagining. We also have the relaunch that we didn't even talk about. You know, we've gone through a relaunch. Now I'm not even sure if we have gone through a relaunch.
Are we a reboot of ourselves?
I don't think we're a reboot.
We're a relaunch.
Are we? Are we a remix?
No, we're not remix.
We did remix, but we also rebooted.
Okay, I think so.
We reworked as well. But that was behind the scenes, and they don't need to know about that.
We actually have remastered a couple of podcasts, too. The first two podcasts, we came up with our format of having the Kool-Aid guy introduce them and stuff, and having the theme song the way it is, and all that different stuff, and the intro and the outro. So we actually did remaster a few podcasts. You can actually go through our Facebook page and see where we mentioned we've remastered episodes, you know, 1 through 3 or
right.
5,
yeah.
whatever it was.
And that's all available in the archive now.
Yep.
Beautifully
BC
organized.
BC Classic, actually.
Yeah.
If we're calling it BC Classic.
I love it.
Well, I'm glad I could sort of turn that discussion into a argument about remix and reboots and reworking, and almost a pointless discussion, and yet we're able to
But isn't that what academia is all about?
Yeah,
it's semantical arguments about this until we come to a consensus, and then we move on to the next semantical argument.
And I'll leave this nugget in for anyone who wants to comment on it. Where do the two CDI Zelda games fit in? Wand of Gamelon.
Those don't exist.
And, oh, they exist. I've played them. Yeah. They exist.
That's
terrible.
That's a good question.
And what about the transmedia? Where does that fit in? Where we've got, say, for example, the Legend of Zelda cartoon series. You know, where does that fit into this?
Well, excuse me.
Exactly.
That's another one of those things, too, where you have to wonder, it's like, what is the canon, what's not the canon, and then, like, you know, is something outside the canon.
But is it a reboot of the story? I mean, how does it view itself?
Yeah, that's a good question.
Even though it's definitely not canon, don't get me wrong, but I'm saying, how does it view itself? Does it view itself as, like, we're now sort of, like, taking the concept of the Legend of Zelda world.
It's a fair point,
and
rebooting
it, because it's very different the way it's presented to.
Sure, yeah.
That sets us up perfectly for the transmedia episode. So stick a pin in it.
Okay. All right, so I guess we're about ready to wrap up then. Go ahead and call this one done.
Cool. So I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
And I'm Doc.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. We bring unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. leave a comment in our podcast section. If it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. This time, which of the rewords would you use to categorize games, and how do you define them? Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.
Backward compatible.